Valentina Gevorgyan is a researcher and writer with experience in research and policy analysis in contemporary social and political fields concerning Armenia. Her academic interests are in the spheres of society-state relations, with a particular focus on public participation and decision-making processes, EU-Armenian relations, democratization processes of the Eastern Partnership, countries in transatlantic relations. Ms. Gevorgyan has served as a senior researcher of a four-year project from 2012 to 2016 on Armenian civil society supported by the University of Fribourg. She has also served as a national expert for a study on public administration reform in the Eastern Partnership countries supported by the European Commission. Ms. Gevorgyan holds an MA degree in political science from the American University of Armenia, and is an Open Society Foundation's Policy Research Initiatives Fellow. Ms. Gevorgyan has published and co-authored articles and reports on civil society, volunteering, and security. She has presented at a number of academic conferences in the region of the South Caucasus and Europe. Currently, she works as a research associate at the Terpanjian Center for Policy Analysis at the American University of Armenia. And with that, I will now pass full control over to Valentina and let her begin her presentation.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, David, for your introduction. I'm excited to be holding this webinar as this is my first such experience, and I would like to thank the ICNC team for providing this opportunity for researchers from all over the world to share their work. And I very much look forward also to your feedback and the interesting discussion with the audience following my presentation. So I'm going to talk about the recent academic study on Armenian civil society, a study which was composed of two parts. The main inquiry of the first part was related to the formal registered civil society organizations, while the second part, and which is the concentration here of our presentation, the second part mainly put in focus the informally developing society or civic activist campaigns or grassroots campaigns, as we call them. The results of the study I will present are based on the case studies of four selected civic campaigns and the qualitative data analysis. You can see on the screen this is the report of the first component, so I'm going to present the second part. Here is the outline of my webinar. I will start with some information about Armenia and proceed with explaining some stages of its civil society development. After that, I will concentrate on the four activist campaigns, followed by looking on methods used in those. I will then proceed to elaboration of campaign similarities and differences, discuss the challenges and problems, impact of campaigns, lessons learned, and conclude with possible prospects for the society at large. So Armenia is an ancient country with a history going back to some 2000 years BC. It is located in the middle of the Caspian and Black Seas, as you can see on the screen. However, Armenia has no access to any of this, and moreover, its two borders out of four available are closed, which is a circumstance which is potentially hindering its economic advancement. According to the Freedom House, Armenia is partially free, and corruption is unfortunately still a vibrant issue in the country. Just a month ago, Armenia celebrated its anniversary of 25th anniversary of independence, which means it's a young country. So speaking about Armenia's civil society, we have to excuse me. We have to keep in mind that it is a post-communist country, and it's characterized. Its civil society is characterized by low membership in the civil society organizations, low trust towards the sector, and disdain of volunteering. A circumstance, however, which is starting to change, but it's a separate subject of discussion. Since mid-90s, there was an abrupt rise of practice of establishing non-governmental organizations. This was the case due to an extensive involvement of external donors encouraging such practice, or democratizing or exporting democracy. Different scholars have labeled this development differently, but this didn't lead to any effective development or impact, but rather contributed to civil society sector becoming more disconnected or detached from the broader public. Roughly since 2007, Armenia witnessed a new form of civil society development as seen in the informally organized groups or civic campaigns. Why is this stage characterized as novel? Because it is new development not seen before, with some distinguishing qualities like a spontaneity of action, independent organization, with participants being mainly youth, and also social media supported and against governmental policies or decisions. Why is this development novel? Why it is new? Because the evidence of up to almost 40 activist campaigns with many successful resolutions in favor of activists. So this serves as a proof and a possibility of change in a variety of sectors, a variety of spheres. So we'll start with this first, with the description of the first case study, which we have on our list. Launched in 2007, Safe Terut is a case of environmental activism against mining operations, the first visible civic campaign and the longest. Terut is a forest in Lori Mars, in the north of Armenia, a forest very rich with flora and fauna. The story started with the Armenian government granting a license to a mining company to exploit what was to become Armenia's second largest mine, covering a huge territory near the village of Terut. Recognizing the devastating impact that mining would have on the community and the nearby communities, the first concerns were raised by civil society regarding the inevitable forest destruction and soil degradation. So the activities to address the issue included appeals to courts, raising awareness of general public about the issue, and striving that the mine becomes a priority on the agenda, on the social and political agenda of the country, and as well as raising attention of the international community. So these were some of the activities addressed by the civic activists. Organizers. The Terut group also appealed to Aarhus Convention Committee of the UN, and the applicants claimed Armenia's violation of the convention's two main principles, public participation in decision-making and access to justice in environmental issues. The committee responded by admitting that the government failed to make its citizens aware of the project, and the response of the committee so was in favor of the activists thus, and the activists interpret this as a partial success, well, due to the fact that the commission favored their position. Apart from a wide range of activities, however, that were implemented by the group, the main goal of the initiative, namely to stop the operation of the mine, wasn't achieved. So in terms of the outcome, this initiative is clearly a failure. However, activists do not give up. Among other activities, they continue contacting the relevant government bodies and providing them with undeniable evidence of the damage currently done to the environment, and also the people who live in the vicinity of that factory. Though not as active as before, the campaign is still ongoing, following the developments in Tehult area and generating ideas to continue the struggle. The vision of activists is that because the ruling government has failed to provide any solution to this issue, they hope that a new political party will emerge, which will come to power with a party program highlighting that Tehult mine site should be closed. The second case that we're going to observe, that we have observed in our study, is an issue of cultural preservation. A 19th century building was built by a rich family, which became known to be the African Club. It was a gathering place of the town's intellectuals where various issues were debated. In 1926, the building was nationalized and taken over by the Soviet security apparatus. In 2014, the place of the building was sold to a construction company, despite the fact that the building was recognized a few years before that by the government of Armenia as a place of imminent public interest. There was a call by the initiators of this of the activists who organized to struggle, of the activists of the group, Let's Preserve the African Club Building, who were concerned with the destiny of the old building. The statement issued by the activists indicated that the building was more than 130 years old, and the stones of the building were enumerated in order to be transported to another place and restored there. However, according to the same statement, such promises regarding other monuments were not carried out before. So the statement ended with the call for the people to join the initiative and, as a sign of solidarity, mentioning this as an opportunity to prevent further destruction of such historic landmarks in the country. The activities of activists that followed included addressing letters to the diplomatic missions in Armenia, including Council of Europe, the European Union delegation, ambassadors of European countries, excuse me. Peaceful rallies were also organized to inform citizens to join the initiative. There was also a performance of a famous piano player to gain attention, also climbing to the roof of the building by activists expected to express complaints, etc. Notwithstanding the support of civil society organizations and individuals, the campaign was not able to live to its purpose, resulting in the demolition of the building. And by September 2014, the building was not in its place anymore. The campaign has stopped and is classified as a failure. At the end of the 2013, the government of Armenia announced a new pension reform to be introduced with a mandatory component for the citizens to pay 5% of their income to a special savings fund. According to the new law, any citizen who was born after 1974 would have to pay 5% of their income to the special personal fund. Special fund, which would be authorized and controlled by the government and the central bank. The money would be kept and invested on their behalf and made available to them upon their retirement. The demem team, which means, and the demem translation from Armenian means I'm against, was established with the main objective to oppose this mandatory component of the reform. So the core team of the activists consisted of some 25 people constantly involved in the campaign. The IT sector specialists were particularly influential here, as they are rather a well-paid group in Armenia, and the 5% loss was perceived as non-trivial for them. It started as a social media discussion platform for people who accidentally heard of the upcoming pension reform. The initiators also used research techniques, so they researched to find out what was the experience of other countries with pension reforms. Here I would like to very importantly mention that therefore the activists contributed to developing a discourse within society on governmental policy that would entail a change which was directly to affect every employed person in the country. The campaign published its main demands to remove the mandatory element from the pension reform, to engage society and consult with different parts of it before making such decisions, and to hold a referendum before enforcing this new reform. Mass demonstrations started beginning of 2014. According to participants' estimates, around 10,000 people attended demonstrations. The emerging public discontent resulted in that the deputies of the Armenian parliament filed an application to the Constitutional Court with the appeal to recognize some of the articles of the reform unconstitutional, which the Constitutional Court actually did, favoring the demands of this group of discontented group of people, including activists and members of parliament and others. In April, following that these developments, the prime minister of the resigned, and many people believed that one of the reasons for this resignation was the pension reform and the opposition towards it. The newly appointed prime minister met with activists and suggested to cooperate. So starting July, the month of July 2014, the pension reform entered into force without the mandatory component. However, this component was not completely dropped from the government's agenda. It has been postponed for several years. So the government is refining the reform package and some of the relevant legislation. And currently the pension reform affects those who voluntarily opt for inclusion. This mandatory component will not enter into force until 2007. However, many believe that the this implementation would hardly happen even then. However, what we need to highlight here that this the delay of this mandatory component would hardly happen if not for the efforts of the campaign and the public demonstration of discontent that the public and activists were successful enough to mobilize. The last case study which I would like to describe, I would like to discuss, is the electric Yerevan, most popular, I believe, among the international community especially. In June 2015, Armenia witnessed the largest in its young history mobilization against the electricity price rise, with thousands of citizens gathering in the center of capital, with protests developing into a two-week rally. The electric Yerevan, most widely known for its name with a hashtag used on Twitter, this has become a subject of attention in international media, with some resembling even the developments to a color revolution and Ukraine's Yevromaidan. Electricity supply in Armenia is exclusively provided by the electric networks of Armenia. Since 2006, the company was owned by a Russian energy holding company, which had increased electricity prices thrice. And as a result, in 2015, people were paying for the electricity almost twice as much as they were paying in 2008. In May 2015, electric networks of Armenia applied to Armenia's public Services Regulatory Commission with a request of raising the electricity price even more, citing low profits and accumulated debts over the past few years. The Commission did not approve the requested increase of 41%, but it did approve a more modest price increase of 17%. So this increase was exactly what sparked the protests, which are now commonly referred to as Electric Yerevan. It has to be noted, however, that the name is somewhat misleading, as the protests were not confined to Yerevan, but quickly spread also to other major cities in Armenia. A group of concerned citizens marched to Bahraman Avenue, which is the central street that houses the parliament, the constitutional court, the presidential palace, and a number of embassies. The protesters were warned by Yerevan's deputy police chief that their march was illegal and that they would be met by police resistance. Nonetheless, the demonstrators proceeded and were met with riot police who had blocked the avenue. Water cannons and other machinery was present on site. At this point, the activists made a decision which was later on described as spontaneous by the participants. So they decided to sit on the street and stay the night. In the early hours of morning, the riot police began dispersing the crowd using water cannons. And there were scores of plainclothes officers participating in the dispersal of activists. Journalists were mistreated by the police as well. Some recording equipment was damaged. Around 250 people were detained in different police stations throughout the city. Around 30 people more were injured. The level of police violence employed during the protest dispersal clearly backfired. On June, several days after the protests started, the morning after the use of water cannons, there were various statements from organizations and officials condemning police violence. Protests resumed and grew in numbers. Police held its positions but did not hinder the demonstrations. Some estimate the number of crowd gathered at the Bahraman Avenue the evening after the water cannon dispersal at around 15,000. Hundreds of citizens would be present on the avenue during the next days. Thousands were joining in the evenings, some also camping on the street overnight. High level of self-organization was evident, and people were bringing and distributing food and water and cleaning after themselves. The atmosphere was peaceful during the day and rather festive in the evenings. The singing, dancing, and drumming, those kinds of things were present. Were actually a constant feature of evening gatherings. I would say there was a strong national element in all of this, and a couple of weddings also took place on the street, adding to the festive mood. End of June, the authorities made concessions, some concessions, and called for the audit and state subsidy to cover the increased electricity price for people, but not for the businesses. Some interpreted this as a partial success. In my view, one of the most interesting aspects of this campaign was its incomparable, really, beginning, a huge spark, and its absolutely, shall I say, invisible end. At its culmination, for many, the campaign has become a hope for a bigger change, with a new leadership emerging and shifting the focus towards political. In early July, however, the street was unblocked, and the electric caravan clearly just failed to create a lasting impact. So we have looked at the four case studies of the four civic campaigns with their resolutions, with two resolutions being as failures and two partial successes. Here I would like to summarize the methods that were used throughout these four campaigns. And so the methods are put under these main categories, with formal statements, including letters and appeals to local and international institutions, public speeches, group or mass petitions, communication with the audience, including banners, posters, leaflets, social media use, certainly, and also two out of the four campaigns have their own websites created. Group representation, including pickets, pressures on individuals, including haunting officials, which was particularly visible in the last case, in the electric caravan. Drama and music, including performances of plays and music, singing, and so on. Processions and public assemblies and protest meetings, including protest meetings. Looking at the similarities and differences between these cases, I would like here to pay our attention to some of the most visible constantly occurring tendencies or patterns, similar patterns or the differences. So the methods, as the first and the most important pattern, serve to be the most visible similarity of the campaigns, the majority of which are the ones, the majority of the methods were used outside in the form of non-violent protest or sit-in, standoff, and so on. Framing also, and I will add at times creative and also powerful framing has been used by activists. Another important similarity is also the way that activists generate material resources. Activists in Armenia participate and engage using their own time and resources, notwithstanding the possibility of some negative perceptions towards and suspicions towards various resource generating techniques by some other public members. The differences, on the other hand, include, for example, open versus closed campaigns. And here it is important to mention that the role, indicate the role of the civil society organizations. There are some stories of successful campaigns, successful meaning positively, with a positive resolution, and thanks to the organizational support and involvement of formal organizations, of NGOs, whereas there were campaigns with a reverse practice. For example, the I'm Against group, the Denim group, has often been characterized as the most organized group with decision-making rules and structures, yet it has also been criticized as closed by some activists who said they wanted to get involved but were not admitted into the inner circle of decision-making, not to mention a possibility of involvement for registered or formal organizations. Stemming from the same argument, the leadership of campaigns is an issue of difference. The so-called closed campaign has a specified leadership, not flexible to change, whereas the Africans case, for example, has been characterized by loose organizational structure, constituting a great difficulty even for researchers like our team, with a difficulty constituting in the fact that simply to find the people who, to find the leaders of the campaign, simply to talk to and to understand the dynamics of the campaign. Time frame also as a difference, as a different issue. Tarut, for example, is an 8-year-long case continuing up to date with Electric Yerevan, for example, which lasted just 2 weeks. So what are the challenges and problems that the Armenian society faces today in the context of this recent development? There is a lack of trust in public at large towards the possibility of change. A change which is going to be achieved via civic activist campaigns. It is important to differentiate here the type of the change I'm talking about. What I refer to is a substantial change visible in the form of change of government, change of a system, and so on. Armenia has a typical post-Soviet political culture, with an unfortunate component being a huge detachment between public and government. Here it is important for the civil society organizations to pay attention and participate by serving as bridges between the two. Armenia has numerous problems, and to recover it will have to undergo an institutional rehabilitation, really, focusing on deficient political party system, striving to achieve an effectively functioning electoral institute, as well as a complete eradication of politicization of institutions, which unfortunately is still a continuing practice in the country in a variety of institutions. I will also add an extremely limited public participation in policymaking processes on the, this is an area of my personal interest and which I hope, an area which I hope will become a sphere, an area delivering success. An undeniable and to me the most important impact of Armenia's recent activist developments is the development cycle of individuals. So preparing for this presentation and specifically the impact and lessons slide, I decided to particularly put this development cycle of individuals as the most important impact on a personal level. So people develop as a result of becoming active, and this cycle of change includes development of understanding, which results in certain actions, which automatically results in certain actions and is an undeniable impact in reaching particular individuals and hopefully spreading them to others in the society. Participation and unity of particular groups proved to be successful also. This practice should be maintained and brought even further in terms of more and united cooperation involving diverse groups. The recent developments demonstrated that participation of females in protests is fine. Moreover, we now have females even leading some of the ongoing campaigns, which is a clear sign of a positive impact for a society which is to some extent rooted in certain patriarchal traditions so far. In our study, we kept this gender dimension in focus. So for those interested in this specific area, I will be glad to share the full manuscript of the study, they can learn more about it, and which will be available soon online by the end of the month. Civic campaigns tend to promote agenda in line with government. We can confidently say this. However, the impact, the lasting impact of these campaigns is limited. And speaking about the physical turnout, it is a clear indication of change in the governmental behavior. Speaking of impact, we have to remember that we have to understand that the number of people is an indication of change in the governmental behavior. So the more people mobilize, the more cautious authorities act. This is what we were able to learn as a result of the campaigns. This means that the number of people in an initiative was able to mobilize might be a determining factor on whether it will become a success or a failure. The civic activists have indeed become the only challengers to power holders today. The civic campaigns have shown that the people power is in check. However, we must also recognize that absolutely all campaigns have been reactions to governmental policies or decisions. The overwhelming majority of participants in our study, from a variety of sectors and settlement types, and knowledgeable people and active people think that activism is needed as long as government behaves wrongly. In other words, if all the policies were okay, there will be no need for any activism at all. I would like to promote this line of argument that just to the contrary, that people have to shift this reactionary approach by constantly being vigilant towards their own society. Being proactive instead of reactive, I believe, is part of the answer to exercise a reality that the Armenian public really aims for. Speaking of the activist campaigns and the recent developments, it will be naive, if not irrelevant, not to mention the recent case of violent resistance that happened in Armenia recently in July. So the summer in Armenia witnessed a violent standoff. The armed group seized the police station. This violent manifestation of actions was a clear demonstration of the level of frustration of certain groups. In this case, it was the Sasnazarej group, the group of veteran heroes who fought in the Karabakh War. It was really, to some extent, a demand or search for more and new or other methods of resistance, because perhaps the traditional protest at times seems to be delivering not much. But I would like to say that violence divides people into camps, and instead of thinking about a common strategy and planning, throughout the history, the nonviolent campaigns have proved to be more effective and more advantageous. Which was also confirmed by the academic literature available. And the last point I would like to make is that more possibilities for engagement are needed and for many and diverse groups. Whether it will be done by activists or civil society organizations, but we need to reach out to the latent layers of population because there is potential, which however has yet to be enacted. The activism or resistance in Armenia is synonymous to protest and should be happening outside, as people observe fewer opportunities for change via other methods of resistance. The Armenian public should be introduced to new methods of engagement, because there is a risk that the general perceptions about civic activism are limited to the art of protest and disobedience on the street, while it is much more to that. It is not only about protesting, but rather developing the skills and strategies for a better and informed involvement based on research and analysis. This was the conclusion of my presentation, but before I finish, really, I would like to thank the our team who participated in the study, as well as I would like to thank the organization which supported us, supported our team throughout the 4 years in this academic study. The academic Swiss Caucus is SNAT, an organization supporting promoting social sciences in the region of the South Caucasus, and supported by the University of Fribourg. So that's it. Thanks for joining, and I'm looking forward to an interesting discussion.
Thank you very much. It was a very fascinating report on an area I know very little about, so I really appreciate it. And it's very thorough. Going to your conclusions, I'm just wondering if I'm reading it correctly. Basically, you're kind of pessimistic in that some of the civic campaigns actually promote government policy and are not really making much change. Maybe individuals change in their own personal life by participation. But I kind of sense that you're saying that some of the things that we assume can maybe undermine a government through nonviolent techniques are actually not happening. And I'm wondering if the volunteers, protesters, and others are reaching out in a way that would be more effective to bring about an actual change of government in terms of working with the business community or perhaps even the military, etc.
Thank you for the question. You raised an interesting and important issue, which leads me back to this importance of reaching out to diverse groups within society. What we have learned is that the civic activists or these activist campaigns have definitely established a practice, of delivering the change. This is something without any doubt. We can see a lot of campaigns with a positive resolution, and this definitely the activists serve to promote agenda in line with the government to some extent. What I meant is, however, that we have in these campaigns several examples of this, several campaigns with a positive resolution. An important factor of these campaigns were that several groups uniting together, such as the civic activists, informal members of the society, uniting with the formal organizations, let's say civil society organizations, delivering an impact, a positive end result. What I meant in my conclusion and what I would like to highlight is that maybe perhaps we need to look forward to this practice and maybe spread it even further, maybe take it even further to another level. As you mentioned about the businesses and other groups, which is not always easy. I'm looking at the Armenian society. However, looking that, understanding that this practice is possible because it happened with the civil society, within the civil society, so reaching out to and including more diverse groups, I believe will be a possibility to create this long-lasting impact, which, and the view of many participants and participants of our study, attained or achieved as a result of these campaigns. So my point is that many people view this positive the resolution of the campaigns as very good decisions, or okay, it was positively resolved, however, in terms of a specific policy, but it did not created a long-lasting impact, as if it did not deliver something more, something bigger, something that would last long. Right. So reaching out to more diverse groups and including them, this will be one of the most, as well as in chorus with the reaching out to the new and new nonviolent and creative techniques also of resistance. So this should be, I believe, the way forward for Armenia.
Great. Thank you, Valentina. Somebody else has their hand raised. Christian, you were unmuted. Go ahead and ask the question.
Yes, thank you very much, Valentina. I really enjoyed the presentation about your work and the work that you've been doing in Armenia. My question probably actually relates to how gender balance is practiced in activism in Armenia. I'm kind of curious to know to what degree, just like you've raised in your conclusion, to what degree are women voices represented and promoted during the activism? I'm just curious to know how you promote that.
This is a very important dimension, which we have also recognized prior to initiating and starting our study. So we have paid a particular attention in our study to this specific component. So we need to recognize both realities. So the first one is that throughout the campaigns, and this may seem also to some extent a strange development, but many campaigns have had this gender component as, let me maybe provide you with some examples, which will be better to understandable. So in some of the campaigns, we have females who are very actively participants, however, encountering some resistance on behalf of the same activists or male participant activists, declaring or developing a discourse on that the females should go back and females should not participate or should not be up front, let's say, in the riots and so on and so forth. So my point is that there still unfortunately exists to some extent this gender let's say putting females as a secondary onto the secondary level or behind the scenes, let's say. But this is only one part of the story. The second reality that we have to also recognize is that we have females participants in becoming leaders of campaigns and actually developing agenda and very actively participating. And so I would say that to the majority of campaigns, the practice of the majority of cases, examples, has shown that this is developing. And we can be proud of saying that, confidently stating that the females are really, we have a better and a greater participation of females. That's obviously, that was obvious throughout campaigns.
Great, thank you, Valentina. Another question. Samuel, you are unmuted. Go ahead and ask your question of Valentina.
All right, I want to find out the strategies that we are using in preventing the women that participate in the protest during the conflict or any particular conflict that may arise or whatever we might have protest for, because I'm looking at the situation where women are going to partake in this particular protest. Are there measures that we are keeping to make sure we protect them from violence?
I'm not sure if I understood. So what's the question about, do we do anything to protect women within protests? Was that the question?
Oh yes. I am looking for the measures we use in protecting women during protest.
Okay, measures used by whom? Do you want to specify, or just general, by authorities, by police, by civic activists? You mean within the campaign, so that the women are protected?
Within the campaign. Within the campaigns.
Well, honestly, I can't say there was a case or particularly employing or enacting a particular range of actions to protect specifically women. What I can say is that women are very vocal and their participation has been so vibrant and visible in some of the campaigns that really didn't leave any need, let's say, didn't provide any need for any measures to be employed. There have been, I would say, certain tries or abuses on behalf of the authorities, on behalf of the police members towards women. This was the line of the argument that I mentioned in the presentation, where that seeing more participation of women in campaigns is actually, for Armenia, is actually a very positive development, considering its post-feminist civil society experience of the traditional society or patriarchal society. That will be my answer. If you are you would like to refer to any particular measures, we can discuss maybe in details.
All right, thank you so much.
Mm-hmm. All right, great. Somebody posted a question. They say, I totally agree with the reactive function of civic activism in Armenia, which cannot bring to long-term democratic changes, and as the cases show, they just have temporary and short-term impact. My question is the following. Have the conducted studies shown what triggers young people in Armenia to participate in social movements? Is it the civic consciousness, or is there a different factor?
We actually have a separate section in our final manuscript that speaks particularly about the involvement of individuals into the campaigns, with coupled with their personal stories and experiences. And most of the time, I would say there are many reasons certainly to that, but most of the time, I would say the people engage as a result of their prior experience of let's say prior sad experience of being a witness to how the things were handled, let's say in a workplace and in a voluntary their NGO or the office, or a story about their friends and so on. So I would like to highlight that this many of the participants highlighted that the had there not been the this previous sad experience, they would probably not get involved into something new. So this involvement in a new involvement and to the campaign and this participating, joining to some civic initiative is something for them. Let's say of they feel something as a fulfillment for them to stop this injustice and so on. So I would say that is the main reason. One of the main reasons is this personal understanding and definitely connected to their prior experience of something wrong, and which was so this experience developing present, developing into something to make their voice heard, to act, to stop the injustices on practice today.
All right, great. We have another question. Somebody asks, what have activists in Armenia done to bring their issues to the international community? Many around the world heard about Electric Yerevan through social media, but are activists doing international media outreach or other international efforts?
Well, some of the activities I believe I mentioned in the description of the cases, let's say applying to the international conventions, also applying to the international organizations, mainly an important, not important, but let's say a popular activity whenever the wrongdoing is happening, and so in order to outreach to the international community, you many cases are characterized by applications to international, representations of international organizations, embassies, and also individuals. I would also mention the important role of diaspora, Armenian diaspora, which has been involved and continues to be involved largely and paying attention to the developments in Armenia. So speaking about international community, we need to always remember the importance and the presence of Armenian diaspora. So yeah, except for the social media and all the online conferences, webinars, spread, the online means of communication, except for those, also this outreach to the diverse groups of people, and Armenians especially, throughout the world.
Mm-hmm. All right, great. Somebody asks, is civil nonviolent resistance part of Armenia's high school curriculum?
I think it is not. I should say it is not. It is definitely not. And Unfortunately, it is not, because I believe that this is how we develop the citizens. This is how a citizen is developed, and this development should start from school. This is actually going back to this question somebody asked about personal reasons leading people to participate. This shouldn't be the way that this education should start from school, and not to the contrary, that a person necessarily encounters a wrongdoing and then it leaves a huge impact on their life, and then they decide to participate, which is, as we see in Armenia's example, is a very good development because it was successful to deliver certain positive results. However, I should say that it is not part of the curricula, and this is an unfortunate development which we need to think about. The government should think about of including, perhaps. However, this only will become possible after the government starts to minimize the politicization of institutions, as I mentioned, as one of the very visible, one of the existing problems in Armenia today.